Feens, broadcasting from Pod Bay 2A, a mile above sea level at Intergalactic Prairie Studios. We alter your locus ceruleus by warming your synapses with rejuvenative radio waves. This keeps a sin flood of statism out of your brain. Can you feel it? Is it working? Is it working? Ben and Lou, is it working? Can you feel it?
I feel it.
Cool, man.
I feel the power of the Feens.
Cool. Me too. And it is Thanksgiving 2014. It's depending on what time zone you're in. You know, it's coming from the day before Thanksgiving into Thanksgiving. And, you know, those of you that listen on the internet will probably be listening in the car to the podcast version later, you know, on the way to over the river and through the woods to grandmother's house we go. You know, there's only one Thanksgiving song, and that's it. Over the river and through the woods to grandmother's house we go. That's the only one. There's you know, tons of Christmas songs, tons of army songs, tons of veteran songs. The veteran songs, all the military songs, a lot of them are instrumental. You know, the big brass stuff of, what was that guy's name?
John Phillips Sousa.
Yeah, that guy. So, you know, but there's only one Thanksgiving song, and it is Over the River and Through the Woods to Grandmother's House. We... That sounded like a munchkin. I'm a little winded because I was out, you know, late at night. I was just out shoveling in the middle of the night because we had a snow, and if I don't go shovel it, you know, it turns into ice because it's going to be warm in the morning. So, you know, warm, but not that warm. So I had to go out and, you know, at 10:30 at night and actually shovel some snow, and I couldn't use the snow blower cause it's 10:30 at night. So, yep, I was just out shoveling. I'm a little winded cause it's really cold out there, and I'm fitty, and I'm out, you know, people die of heart attacks doing that stuff, and I don't want to do that. Okay. So Ben is going to give dissertation today about Thanksgiving and the true meaning of Thanksgiving. And it's going to be a sweet and wonderful affair. And I'm going to tell a story about Thanksgiving. But Lou, do you have a story about Thanksgiving? And if not, tell me about your deer hunting the last couple of days.
Well, I am broadcasting from my deer blind out at beer camp. I mean, deer camp.
I like that. Do you make that up, or is that a thing?
Beer camp, that's a thing.
Okay.
Yeah, here in Michigan, everybody goes to the UP, goes out, hunts during the day, comes back to the tent at beer camp and drinks beer and plays euchre.
Yeah. Well, I don't know what euchre is, but, you know, firearms and liquor. Well, I don't know. It's liquor. It's beer.
Beer.
If you drink enough of it, it's liquor. It turns into liquor in your belly. So.
Yeah. And it's also generally cheap beer, too.
Yeah. So. Even if you have a lot of money, is the custom to get cheap beer for hunting?
Probably, yeah.
What do you think? What kind of beer do you think that guy drinks who is the host of the Fly Fishing and Maserati Repair Radio Show? I love that show, by the way.
Oh, I'm sure he drinks some kind of really fine craft beer from Pabst Blue Ribbon
that requires a lot of maintenance.
Yeah, Pabst Blue Ribbon Summer Ale.
Well, cool, man. Did you get a deer?
No, I didn't. I went out today, and I didn't see diddly squat. Didn't see anything yesterday. I was hunting on state land, unknown property. Yeah. And the area that I hunt, there's a lot of cornfields around there. It doesn't look like they've been chopped down by the farmers. So I think the deer are probably hanging out in there. And plus, it's also almost a week and a half into the season. So, yeah, I think a lot of the deer population that would be available to take out has been taken out already.
There's this town in Wyoming called Metitzi, which is known for being mentioned in the Beavis and Butthead Do America movie because Beavis just loves the name Metitzi, Metitzi, when they drive through it and or go on the bus trip through it. My wife and I were driving through there one time, and we pulled over, and our jaws just dropped. It was late autumn. No, when was it? When is corn? When? Basically, we saw probably 1,000 deer in a cornfield, like decimating a cornfield. It was actually after the harvest, but they were, you know, in there getting stuff that had fallen on the ground. I mean, literally, this would have been an opportunity for not just legally blind, but fully 100% blind people could have done some hunting that day easily.
Yeah, on the way home yesterday and today, I saw a cornfield that was chopped down and was loaded full of geese. I never see that many geese when I'm hunting out on a little pond out in the back in the middle of nowhere, but I always see them on the golf courses and in the parks on the way home.
Yeah.
But for this is my first year hunting deer in quite a while. I haven't really hunted in the past probably maybe 10 years, I'd say. And one of the traditions I had was I would go up to the Upper Peninsula with my father, and he had a cabin up there. And we would go do some deer hunting. We'd get up there the weekend before Thanksgiving and go out there and deer hunt. And really, we didn't take it too seriously because we didn't get out there super early in the morning. And I think we chose our hunting locations more on scenery than deer shooting possibilities. Well, and if you're going to sit there all day, you should have something pretty to look at.
Yeah.
But, so we'd go out there, and we also have some friends that we would go visit in different places up in the area. And there was this one restaurant that we used to go to for the buffet Thanksgiving dinner. And I know a lot of people have problems with folks working on Thanksgiving and the Black Friday and everything else. But I tell you what, I sure did appreciate those people that were cooking up those meals. And there were a lot of deer hunters up there that were going in there because they didn't want to cook out at deer camp, or they didn't want to take the time out of their day. They want to be able to go in and have a meal prepared for them already. And there were even a lot of families that went there. So
yeah,
for those people, I thank them for their service.
The market will provide. Yeah. I'm actually thinking about a TV show from a long time ago. I know you're telling heartwarming stories about real people, but the Beverly Hillbillies, I'm thinking about this really unsafe kind of gangsta style gunplay in one of the Beverly Hillbillies where Mr. Drysdale takes them to he's embarrassed, but he takes them to the Beverly Hills Gun Club, and they're skeet shooting in Beverly Hills on this large tract of land that is probably, you know, condos or banks now. And Jed Clampett is skeet shooting on Thanksgiving with a rifle. If you don't know anything about guns, that's, first of all, it would be much, much, much harder, and you'd have to be much better shot to do skeet shooting with a rifle than with a shotgun. But, and the other thing is, it would be extraordinarily bad gun safety, you know, because a shotgun, the pellets are likely to disperse and not have a lot of energy before they, you know, when they hit the ground. A rifle in Los Angeles, I mean, he's basically doing what gangbangers do on the 4th of July there. You know, he's firing a gun into the air, and that bullet could probably, you know, go to Echo Park and land in someone's neck. Maybe not Echo Park, but Hollywood, you know. So
yeah, definitely not a good thing. I've had birdshot or steel shot land on top of me while out duck hunting because somebody was on the other side of the lake and they fired off a couple rounds. And the steel shot or the regular field shot only goes probably a couple hundred yards, and then it just, you know, drops out of the sky. It's not a very high velocity either. So it's like, I don't know, maybe like a little tiny twig falling out of a tree.
You know, yeah, I mean, fall. You know, past 100 meters, a leather jacket will, you know, his body armor against birdshot. Probably not even at 100 yards. It probably won't even go that far. But, you know, I'm not saying I'm willing to stand 100 yards away from you and have you shoot me with birdshot while I'm wearing a leather jacket. But, yeah.
Yeah. Well, I've taken some clay pigeons at some pretty long distance. So I'd say a couple hundred yards and you're fairly safe. Yeah. But it is best not to be there.
Yeah. Mama Liberty shot someone with birdshot at a pretty close distance. I'm sure some of them lodged into the guy. It was someone that was at her house trying to kill her and, you know, was armed and was, I don't know, I think she said he was like, you know, 30 feet away and walking toward her. And she'd warned him a few times, get off her property. And there was, you know, out in the middle of nowhere. And she said, I'm going to shoot you. And he said, you won't shoot, and kept walking toward her. And she shot him. She did what I would not recommend doing and what she would not do now, which was she shot over his head, but some of them, you know, basically fell, or, you know, basically he grazed his face and he ran away screaming. Yeah, man, she's in the movie Guns and Weed, The Road to Freedom. And she is the lady that gave me my classes for my gun safety training. And we're big on gun safety here. So if you're out with your family drinking beer, hunting beer on Thanksgiving or, you know, anytime, we recommend you practice gun safety. And the four rules of gun safety are always on the Freedom Fiend site. And we're not going to bum out your Thanksgiving by reciting them to you, because we've done it like every show for a while now. So I'll tell my Thanksgiving story really quickly. I was, and you know, like my family memories of Thanksgiving are just kind of like warm and fuzzy and food comas. And I guess the thing I resent about holidays, and we're not trying to bum anyone out here today. We want everyone that's gone their way to their families, you know, listening to this in the car, to have a great time and a safe time. But I guess the thing I don't like about holidays is it's kind of like programming of society of telling you how to feel on a certain day. It's very collectivist. You know, this day you're thankful. This day you're patriotic. This day you're in love and exchange hearts. You know, this day you celebrate the Lord's birthday by giving your relatives cheap pieces of plastic made in Japan. Yeah, I don't buy it, man. I'm kind of the Quaker. I'm not a Quaker, but Ben tells me that in Quakerism, the Quakers don't value any one day over another, and I like that. So I was preparing a Thanksgiving dinner when I was, about 29, and with some friends at my house in San Francisco when I used to live in San Francisco. And I accidentally cut myself, you know, not horribly, but bad enough to go to the ER. And I went to the ER, and it was like 1 in the afternoon, and there was nobody there, man. It was totally empty. And they saw me in like an hour. Like, that's never happened to me at an ER for for something like that. Like, usually it's hours and hours and hours. So they finally see me. They stitch me up. They're ready to send me home. And I was like, it's really empty here, man. Where is everybody? And he's like, it's like this every Thanksgiving. It's completely empty until 5 or 6 or 7 o'clock. And then we get inundated with drunk people with blunt head force trauma. That is a true story. And that says everything you need to know about the idea of once a year getting a bunch of people together who normally don't mix and probably shouldn't, and adding alcohol and like pressure to, you know, have a happy face no matter what. Yeah. So what say you guys before we go to the break here?
Honesty is the best policy. You should love your family all the time if you can tolerate them.
From a distance, if that makes it better.
Yeah.
Yeah. Freedom Feens. Worms.
You and the hamster in your brain are listening to Freedom Feens with Michael Dean and his weird friends.
So we're back on the Freedom Fiends, and Mr. Ben Stone, the Bad Quaker, is going to drop some mad scientists and tell you the truth about Thanksgiving. And it's not necessarily pretty, but we want to say this all with love. We don't think anyone's a bad person for celebrating Thanksgiving. We just want to have Ben tell the truth about it. And here's the thing. After you hear this on your way over the river and through the woods to Grandmother's house, if you hear this in the car and a family member doesn't make you turn it off, go ahead and listen to it, and we're going to absolve you. The libertarian central planners here are going to absolve you. You're allowed to go have this one Thanksgiving and forget everything you just learned, but you should come back and listen to this episode again and know the truth about Thanksgiving, because we're trying to do this with love. So Ben, slay us with love about Thanksgiving.
Yeah, and I should mention that Thanksgiving is actually my wife's favorite day of the year. We every year, except this year, because we're on the road in the motorhome this year, so we're not doing it. But every other year, you know, she makes a big thing, and family members come from all over. And sometimes we've had really big deals that were like a week long for Thanksgiving. And so I'm not in any of this. Don't translate any of this as saying thou shalt not obey Thanksgiving. It's not like that. It's like, you know, if you can get together with your family and you can have a positive time and you can, you know, share the love with each other, hey, do that. That's great. But you just, you know, the thing about truth is that no matter how warm and fuzzy and squishy and spongy the lies are, the truth always has in it something better. And so that's what we're going to talk about today, is the real story of Thanksgiving. But even, you know, Christmas and 4th of July and Veterans Day and Memorial Day and Halloween and all that. For me, Ben Stone, the Quaker in the family, I don't I don't care one day over the next. They're all the same to me, and they mean absolutely nothing. And we could just as easy have, you know, Christmas on July 15th as we have it on December 25th. Because, you know, the one day we can almost be assured that Jesus was not born was December 25th, if you actually go in and look at the history. But so it's just a day that somebody picked out and everybody else follows along with it. But on the other hand, in my household, if members of my family, if that's important to them, then I don't stop them from having that day as the day that they do it. I don't bring down some kind of edict, and I don't, you know, pound some kind of law that this is how it's going to be. And that's kind of our intent here. We can still enjoy the family, enjoy friends, have a good time, do the things that we do. It's just my opinion that if we understand the truth, then when we have these family gatherings and we have these events like this, you're having it based on truth, not based on a bunch of government lies that have been fed to you to manipulate you and get you to behave in a certain way so that they can rush you out of the house really quick at, you know, at 6 o'clock on Thursday afternoon and tell you that it's now Black Friday. Quick, go out and throw yourself into debt over your ears. You know, that's probably not a good idea. It's probably better to stay right in there with your family and just enjoy the evening. Don't drink too much. Try not to bash your head into anything. And try not to let your family
and try
bash
not to bash anything into anybody's head. Yeah.
Yeah. You know, it's a time of retrospect and a time to think about things. But then again, every day should be a day to give thanks and to have a retrospect and to learn the lessons of life that come with every day. And that's where wisdom develops from. It's from looking back and seeing your mistakes and being honest with yourself and seeing what you did that worked over the course of the year, over the course of the week or whatever. And that's where wisdom is really developed. And if we can get into that today and not so much, you know, we're not laying down some kind of laws that say thou shalt not, and we won't talk to you or answer your email if you have we're not going to do that. That's not the whole point. The point is that we just understand the truth of where these things come from, and we find out how, and this may be more important than just the things that I spit out today, how do you find out these things? How do you get in there and dig around and get past all the lies that society pushes on you and all the lies that the different sellers want to sell you things so they're willing to say anything? How do you get past all that? And you get in and you find out what history was really like and what really happened, and you get past the myth and you start to see human beings in the past the same way that they are now. They're not magical. They weren't great geniuses. They made mistakes just like we make. And they didn't understand everything just like we don't understand everything. So that's our goal today.
Yeah. That's our goal. And we'll be back after this trip to the free market. And you can run in the other room and grab some turkey. We'll be back.
Freedom Fiends with Michael Dean. This is what radio sounds like now.
Cock-a-doodle-doo! Happy Thanksgiving from the Freedom Fiends. So, Lou, what did you see on the way to shoot non-existent deer today?
I saw a government sign on the side of the road. It was one of those electronic signs, and it said, "Expect enforcement. Give thanks." And all on the radio, and I was listening to conservative talk radio again today, and it really reminded me of Air America with all the government should do this. We need state funding for that, but that's a whole other story. But there were all these discussions about the state police and everybody out looking for more revenue. I mean, taking drunk drivers off the road to make us safer, and talking about how this is the day of the year where the most drunk drivers are apprehended and all this other stuff. And it's just really horizontal reinforcement or horizontal enslavement. I don't know. Call it whatever you want.
You know, when we were traveling around through Missouri a few months back, I noticed
when things were good and you could do that.
Yeah.
Yeah, I wouldn't do that right now, man. They're burning cars all over that state and worse.
But I noticed something on the freeways.
I'm not just talking about police cars. They are like setting their own neighborhoods to the ground, burning rows of cars, burning, you know, stores, burning all sorts of things. It's yeah, man. I'm really glad I'm not living in a big city. That's what I'm thankful for today, is that my wife and I got out of Los Angeles 5 years ago and moved to rural Wyoming, where the deer and the buffalo play, the deer and the antelope play, man. It's nicer. Yeah.
I'm with you on that. Absolutely.
They're protesting in Detroit now. It started yesterday. They're late for everything. But from what I heard on the radio this morning, there were no arrests. Nobody was injured. Nothing got burned down. Nothing was destroyed. So, hey, Ferguson, if you're destroying more stuff than Detroit, you're doing it wrong.
Yeah, it sounds like other cities have become the new Detroit. Like Detroit collapsed enough that now the people are rebuilding it in a way. And, you know, that town, isn't that the town that used to be known for Hell Night?
Yes.
Night before Halloween, people would
arson. Yeah, Devil's Night.
Yeah, would set usually abandoned, but sometimes not abandoned houses on fire. Yeah, horrible, man.
Yeah,
horrible.
They changed it to Angel's Night, and they had people going out and walking around doing patrols. They had everybody leaving their porch lights on and begging and pleading with the vandals and miscreants to not burn down their city. And it's...
I'm surprised no pranksters came up with something like a viral email that says, on Angel Night, if you have your porch light on, people, a gang initiation is to throw a bottle, you know, to throw a Molotov cocktail at your house.
Well, email didn't come to Detroit until like a couple of years ago.
Okay, there you go. Good. Yeah, man. All right. So, Ben, tell us the truth about Thanksgiving.
Yeah, real quick on the road signs first. When we were going through Missouri, I guess the big thing in Missouri is don't text while you drive. We're seeing that everywhere, but it was really big in Missouri. And so they have this flashing
it's big
sign
here, too. And they have these in Wyoming. They've taken a bunch of government money to make these really poorly produced ads on TV. I mean, like, the average YouTube video is better filmmaking than these things. And, like, even the text on them is done with, like, you know, an analog video toaster from like, you know, 1981. Public access TV kind of look, you know, kind of like the blinking text at the beginning of South Park, but you know, a little fancier with colors, and it spins in your face to emphasize things. And they have these, like, I think they're produced by the local community college, like theater class or something, but, you know, and the filmmaking is horrible. Not saying the local actors are bad, but, you know, they use what they can. They do what they can. They spend a bunch of government money on this, and they make these morality plays. Like, you know, if it shows that the boyfriend and the girlfriend on opposite ends of town texting to each other, the teenagers, and, like, you know, it's I love, and then the letter Y, and then it's a gruesome death. And then it's, you know, it's a 30-second ad, and they're, no, I would never text and drive. And, I wouldn't mind that stuff produced by the free market and not backed by government guns. I see cops texting all the time, man. It's illegal in my state.
But they have shiny badges, so that grants special privileges and rights.
They're not just texting. I've driven past a cop and seen a cop using his laptop computer while driving.
Well, hey, you got to check that status every now and again.
Yeah. All right, so
get,
go on.
Get on the face base.
I'll get off this. Go on, y'all.
So anyway, the signs in Missouri, the flashing lights signs that are, you know, solar operated beside the highway, there's like almost whole paragraphs telling you not to text and how dangerous texting is.
You're going to like have to stop and like slow down and be distracted and read. Yeah.
Yeah. You're reading like a
you're
small
reading a
paragraph.
Text. You're reading it's a text. You are reading a text while driving. Yeah.
They're telling you not to text by giving you a text.
And that's probably less safe. If you actually read it, it's probably less safe than reading a text on your chromed robot turd handheld mobile while you're driving, because while you're driving, you can look for a safe opportunity. You know, there's no cars behind me, there's no cars in front of me, just really quick, you know, you're driving somewhere and you want to see, you know, if the location changed or something before you hit the wrong exit. You know, that you can do fairly safely. You know, it's easy, and reading a text is a lot safer probably than writing a text. But yeah, man, reading a paragraph of text on a flashing sign that's stationary and you have to read it to read it, you'd have to read it while you're driving by it, regardless of what the traffic conditions are, and you don't have any choice in it. Yeah, man, that is that's the government making you read a text, telling you it's illegal to read a text while driving.
Perfect sense. So I suppose we should talk about Thanksgiving, huh?
Yeah, man, lay it on me.
So the myth of Thanksgiving, of Thanksgiving Day, often starts with one of two lies. It's typically either the Pilgrim lie or the George Washington lie. And I'm going to just touch on the George Washington lie really quick, because that's the one that's least often told, but it's the one that seems to have the most substance to it, even though it's entirely fake. So on October 3rd, 1789, now realize George Washington was literally just elected and the Constitution was just signed and it's a brand new government. And they had not only been in war for years, but they came out of that war and the soldiers who had been fighting in the war came back to find out that the states, the individual states, had invented a new thing called a property tax. And while these guys were off fighting the war, the states were piling up these property taxes. So when the soldiers came back, not only did they have the insult of finding out that they weren't going to get paid for the years that they had fought, but they had the injury added to that, that they found out that the states were in the process of foreclosing on their farms for this new property tax that they'd never heard of before and never had to pay before. And so this sparked up a thing called Shay's Rebellion that you're almost never taught about in school. So we've got the end of the war. George Washington and his little elite group of people take control of the Continental Congress, push through the Constitution, and Washington is elected. And as that's taking place, Shay's Rebellion is quenched. Washington becomes president, and almost immediately he sends out, and he was urged by Congress to do this, he sends out this letter to the governors of the states suggesting a day of prayer and thanks for the course of the war and the conclusion of the war. And in his words, he said that the people should beseech God to pardon our national and other transgressions.
Oh, man.
Now, it's important to realize that he didn't mention family gatherings. He didn't mention eating together. He didn't mention watching sports or turkeys or pilgrims or the harvest. This was not about the harvest, as is the myth often is associated with this.
I got to interject. If a Democrat did that today, Republicans would say he's apologizing for America and yell at him.
Yeah, it's a very socialist statement. Pardon our nation for our transgressions. Okay.
I also got to say, with the Shay's Rebellion thing and what that's all led to now, and it all started with Washington, the standing army, the one amendment that Constitution lovers and quoters never talk about is the Third Amendment, the one against quartering soldiers in the home. That is broken all the time. They're not literally quartered in our home. But, and stay with me here, this is not a stretch. They are quartered in homes in your neighborhood that are nicer than your home at your expense. And they exist to violate your rights, man. They exist, you know, the war on drugs, the war on guns, you know, the war on milk, the war on, you know, not having a muffler on your car or having a muffler on your gun, as Boston Tea Party says. Any number of non-crimes, things that don't have victims, that there are these people with all these benefits, good salaries, you know, I mean, like, I don't have health insurance and, you know, a starting cop makes more money than I do. And, you know, a starting guy whose job is to take away guns has, you know, has dental and good health care and all sorts of things like that, man. They are being quartered in your home, technically, you know, more or less by having the standing army of the police. And police arresting people and harassing people and shooting people's dogs and shooting people when the people aren't committing crimes. And that happens more and more all the time. So, yeah.
To interject a little something here. Sorry, Ben. I recall hearing a story not too long ago. And if memory serves me correctly, there was a family that they had their home and the cops wanted to set up in there to do some drug sting or raw milk sting or I don't know.
Oh yeah.
Anyway, do surveillance on a little girl's lemonade stand. And the family refused, and I believe they were arrested, and the cops used their place anyway.
Yeah, I remember when that took place.
Yep, that was it. And that's being challenged on actually on Third Amendment. I think the ACLU might be involved in that one.
Okay, do I have the facts on that correct?
Yeah, it wasn't about a little girl's lemonade stand. It was about domestic violence. But yeah, it was basically police saying, we want to quarter in your home and peep through your shades and, you know, have you bring us coffee.
It should also be noted that prior to the War of Independence, when the Declaration of Independence was written and the complaint was made about quartering soldiers, specifically the soldiers in question were essentially police. They were soldiers that were assigned to the governors.
Yeah.
They were exactly like sheriffs are today. That's exactly the role that they played. The fact that they wore a uniform, well, sheriffs wear a uniform today. It's exactly the same thing. And those soldiers that fired on the people, those young men at Boston, at the Boston Massacre, those were the governor's soldiers. So those were essentially the sheriff's department. That's who those guys were.
Yeah.
And that's who the complaint was against.
Yeah, and speaking about uniforms, too, more and more often, sheriffs and state police and even local police kind of switch skins and go into military mode. Like, you know, in a lot of places, you'll see cops now in battle fatigues.
Yeah.
It's pretty bizarre. And often with, like, you know, no number or name on the uniform.
Yeah.
You know, like a private thug army or the mafia or something. All right. Happy Thanksgiving. Sorry to bum y'all out. We'll be back and uplift your spirits with stories about the founding fathers and George Washington and what a great man he was.
You're listening to The Freedom Fiends, an invigorating alternative to those other shows.
Freedom Fiends, happy Thanksgiving. This is the Thanksgiving episode on 2014. It's the 27th of November now, and we're going to have Ben Stone tell us more about the truth about Thanksgiving. So you got more on George Washington, the great man there?
Yeah, and just to wrap it up for the first hour here, and we're going to come back with some more on this on the second hour, but just to wrap it up, we want to emphasize that this that what we want to bring is truth, because truth, sometimes truth is a little bit painful, but truth always carries with it the reward of itself. Truth always brings a knowledge that's deeper than any fluffy feel-good lies. And so when you have a choice between believing the truth and finding the beauty and the wonders that are in the truth, if you compare the two, if you could imagine holding the truth in one hand and holding some fuzzy lie that the government has fed you through their government schools, even if it doesn't seem like it initially, the truth is going to be much better than that fuzzy, cream-filled lie that's been fed to you. So that's what we're shooting at. We're not here to try to tear anything down. We're here to try to underpin everything with truth rather than a series of fluffy lies that just, in the long run, support government and the government ideas.
Mashed potatoes and lies?
Yeah.
Yeah.
So Washington did, on October 3rd, 1789, he did send a letter to the governor saying, hey, I think we should have this day of Thanksgiving. Now, and this is something that you really need to understand. If you go and look up Thanksgiving Day in Wikipedia or whatever, you're going to find a lot of, I'm not going to say it's outright lies, but I'm going to say it's intentionally fluffing a story to make it seem like something's happened that hasn't.
It's a hagiography, and hagiography is a word that means a celebration of the saints. That's the literal meaning of it, and in the kind of figurative meaning, it is, you know, polishing up the image of somebody posthumously to make them look a lot more pure than they were.
Yeah. So the word Thanksgiving, and to say this is a Thanksgiving day, prior to about 1863, the word Thanksgiving or Thanksgiving Day was thrown around quite a bit. Like we might say car wash or haircut, or, I mean, it was just a regular part of life. And so you might say, you know, I was out chopping wood today and this tree jackknifed when I wasn't expecting it. It just barely missed me. I'm having a day of Thanksgiving for that. Yeah. And this was something that was incorporated into pretty much everybody in the English speaking world's everyday lives. So when you have some explorer that's going around the North Pole or trying to, and he barely escapes with his life, and he proclaims a Thanksgiving day on the day that he lands on dry land, it's not because that was a special magic government sanctioned, day in the last week of November or whatever, or however they do it in Canada. It's because pretty much any day that something good happened in those days, they would proclaim it as a Thanksgiving day. And oftentimes, as often as Thanksgiving included feasting, Thanksgiving included fasting. So it was not only just to get together to eat a lot of food. It was a very religious thing where it was often a sorrowful thing where people would repent or try to do penance if you were, of that area of faith. And it was a day of reflection, and it was a day of solemnness. And so it wasn't necessarily a celebration day, but it could be if something great happened. Hey, you had a good childbirth. Let's have a day of Thanksgiving. And that's what it was all the way up until 1863. Now, I'm going to tell you a real quick little story that happened in 1863.
You got a minute.
A guy named John Sherman, he was a senator from Ohio and brother to the dirty, rotten William Tecumseh Sherman. He made a speech. He was attempting to say, this is how we can get people to be more socialist and have a national unity rather than them following after the state. So I'm going to quote a chunk of his speech here. He says, nationalize as much as possible to make men love their country before their states. All private interests, all local interests, all banking interests, all interests of individuals, everything should be subordinate now to the interest of the national government.
Wow.
And you can find that in the book, The Greatest Nation on Earth, page 83, by Heather Cox Richardson.
And that is God off the throne. Who said that?
It is. That was John Sherman, senator from Ohio and brother to William Tecumseh Sherman. And when we come back in the next hour, we're going to talk about what Lincoln did in response to John Sherman's speech that he gave.
Excellent. Thank you, Professor Ben Stone, the Bad Quaker. We'll be
back. Thank you, Michael.
After this trip to the free market and some national and local news that'll scare the heck out of you. And then we'll come back and give you some more truth that'll make you feel a little better.
And some warm and fuzzies.
Warm and fuzzies, yes. This is the Freedom Fiends, broadcasting to the Libertarian Re-Education Center's Low Orbit Ion Cannon on Thanksgiving, high atop Financial Beast Plaza on the artificial satellite Live There 2017 in the Alpha Centauri region. My name's not important. Only my words and my message are important. I'm kidding. I saw that in some movie. I thought it was funny. It's actually in the movie, you know what movie that's in? It's an awesome movie that everyone should go see, Ben Stone, the Bad Quaker. I am Michael Dean. We got Ben Stone, the Bad Quaker, and Lousander Feen. How you doing, guys?
Hey, hey.
Woof, woof.
Yeah. The Time Machine, that movie from 1960. Have you seen it?
Oh, yeah, yeah, yeah.
Amazing movie. And it's a really good... Have you seen it, Lou?
I've seen the remake with... what was his name? The guy from Memento, Guy Pearce.
Really? I need to see that. Is it good?
Oh, it's very good.
Yeah, and it's kind of a good, it's based on a book written in like 1890-something, and it's a good parable or an allegory, I would say, for where nannyism leads to, because this is no spoiler alert for something made in the, made 54 years ago. In the movie, the guy takes the time machine into the distant future, and humanity has evolved into two subspecies, the Eloi and the Morlocks. And the Morlocks are, rough and tumble, kind of beast-like men who live underground and farm the surface-dwelling Eloi, who are basically hippies. They're basically, blonde, simple creatures who can, they can talk, but they, like, you know, they can't read. They don't have any reason to read. They don't have any desire for knowledge. They can't survive on their own. And the Morlocks bring them food and then eat them. Like, halfway through the movie, I was like, my wife had seen it. And I was like, why do the Morlocks bother to feed them? And my wife said, why do we feed cattle? And that's where having
why do we pay taxes?
Yeah. Having the state defend your every little need will lead to you being Eloy and the Morlocks of the state eating you figuratively or literally. All right. So Ben Stone, the Bad Quaker, since we're talking about food and eating, it is Thanksgiving. Are you done with the truth on George Jefferson? No, George Washington.
I have a little bit more, and we should repeat what we said last hour, that we're not here to ruin anybody's day.
Nope.
You know, if you're getting together with friends and family and you're having a good time, that's really important. It's good to have a time when people can get together like that with their loved ones. And if you, you know, if you enjoy sports and this is a good day for it, watch a football game or whatever, and if you're inclined to do so, to have an adult beverage responsibly, then, you know, we're not saying don't do any of those things. Enjoy those things. We're not even saying don't go shopping on Friday. We're not even saying that. We're just saying that realize what the truth is in understanding these things and understand how to find the truth, and then you'll be a lot more comfortable with what it is that you do and why you do it. Yeah. So in last hour, I read a thing. I want to just reread this again. It's really short. This is from John Sherman. He was a senator from Ohio. In 1863, he said this on the Senate floor. He was also the brother to the dirty, rotten William Tecumseh Sherman. He said, and I'm required to say that because I'm saying this from Alabama, and we're right next door to Georgia, so you have to say that, otherwise people will attack you. Not really. and we haven't said this so far in the show, Michael, so we probably should give our typical disclaimer that Barack Obama is a liar and a socialist, and his feet stink. Isn't that right?
Yeah. You know what's one of the most offensive things about Thanksgiving to me is the pardoning of the turkey.
Yeah.
I heard this year the turkey's name was Wilson.
I don't get it.
Darren Wilson.
Oh.
Too soon.
The
too
cop soon. In, yeah. You're going to cause radio riots. All right, man.
So in 1863, this guy, John Sherman, said the following thing in his speech. And I should give just a little bit. His speech was aimed at, here's a problem we have in America. People don't love the national government enough, and we need to get them to love the national government more so they won't try to break off and become their separate things. So that was the intent of his speech. And he said that the answer was, and this is a quote, nationalize as much as possible to make men love their country before their states, all private interests, all local interests, all interests, the interests of individuals, everything should be subordinate now to the interest of the national government.
You know,
and now,
you know,
go ahead.
Go ahead. No, go ahead. Yeah.
So the same year he said that, Lincoln made a proclamation declaring a specific national Thanksgiving Day. And it's important that we understand that prior to this, a Thanksgiving Day was any day that you might have with your family, or you might, you know, a ship lands successfully. Hey, let's have a Thanksgiving Day. You have done something horrible. You regret it. You feel sorry and you want to apologize to God. So you have a Thanksgiving Day. It was not something that was given out by the government on a specific day. It was an individual thing that anybody who did it owned it. It was not a government sanctioned moment that we're allowed to have on one specific day. So now in Lincoln's proclamation, and
it's you know what it is? It's like Yom Kippur for Christians. It's the day of exactly. Atonement. Yeah, that's what it used to be.
Except you could have it any day that you needed it. So
I think everybody should have one of those. And, you know, people in AA kind of do, like, you know, you do an ongoing assessment and inventory of your actions and your wrongs and promptly make amends to people. And I like a lot about AA. I was in it for a long time, not in it anymore. Still sober. It's over 20 years now. You know, I was thinking about the sort of brain hack that they do in AA to allow atheists and agnostics to participate in a spiritual program. And it's the thing of find your own higher power, you know, higher power of your own understanding, which is actually, if you read about the history of AA, it's actually like a trick that they came up with to allow agnostics and atheists to get sober in a Christian and even a spiritual and even Christian program. It's kind of a brain hack. It kind of reminds me, I've never thought of this before, it reminds me a lot of people who say, I love my country, but I don't trust my government.
Well, what exactly is the country without the government?
A bunch of trees and rocks and lands and mountains.
Is it just the space in between four GPS coordinates?
Yeah, and I really want to have someone make that flag, because that's really what you're worshiping when you worship the flag. You're worshiping, you know, distilled down to the lowest component. That is what you're worshiping, is four GPS coordinates. And then in smaller letters, you know, smaller numbers below that, there'd be a list of, you know, GPS coordinates of like Guam and, you know, Puerto Rico and the overseas holdings. But yeah, man.
An ever expanding list.
Yeah, there you go. Yeah. And, you know, the U.S. and any empire, and empires are always doomed. You have to look at history. You know, a lot of smart people who love America are getting out of America. They're going places that they have a better chance of keeping their money and their life in the coming years. I'm not saying I hate America. I love living here. I've been all around the world, unlike most people who blindly say they love wherever they were born, which people say all over the world. Okay, Ben, tell me more. Tell me more.
Okay, so why in the world would Lincoln make a proclamation like he did? Well, it's what I was talking about in the last hour. Washington did a similar thing, except Washington didn't have the audacity to say, this is what we're going to do. We're going to do it every year. It's going to be a national thing. He didn't do that. He just said, hey, let's have a day of unity where we can all feel sorry for the transgressions, and we can, you know, thank God for all the things that have come to pass here. And Washington did not attempt to make it a nationalized thing. But Lincoln did, because Lincoln had a real problem on his hands. He was right in the middle of a war that had been started with a whole line of propaganda and lies. And he's right in the middle of a war where you might argue that there was no good side. I'm not here defending the Confederacy in this thing at all. And I'm certainly not going to defend the aggressions of the Northern of the Union. But so you've got this war that's going on, and there's no good side.
You just hate everybody, don't you, Ben? Anybody listening who has any opinion about the Civil War just went, these people are horrible.
But Lincoln had some real problems. They had in New York City, the draft was you know, just like it was in the 1960s in America. They were drafting the poorest and the least likely to have any interest in this war. And there were riots in New York City, and Lincoln had to actually pull troops away from the battlefield in Gettysburg. And I believe there was something like 15,000 troops or something like that. I'll glance through my notes and find this in a second. He had to pull them away from the battlefields of Gettysburg, sent them into New York City to kill the riots. And how they killed the riots was that they literally just started shooting down streets. And according to Ivor Bernstein in the book, The New York City Draft Riots, troops literally mowed down thousands of draft protesters, just shot them dead in the streets of New York City. And this is what Lincoln was facing when he decided, you know, here's a pretty good trick. Let's do that thing like Washington did, except let's make it a solid day and let's have it every year. And so he made this proclamation that has been called by one historian a masterpiece of lies, deception, and false propaganda that would have impressed any 20th century tyrant. That's wow. From the historian Thomas De Lorenzo. So Lincoln made this proclamation, and you can get this on the internet. Just you know, Google Lincoln Thanksgiving.
I'm doing it. I just did it. Yeah. Yep.
Yeah. And he says in here. Go ahead,
Ben.
Well, let me throw something in here regarding the draft riots and conscription specifically. When people say that the war of Northern aggression or the war to preserve the Union or whatever you want to call it was about ending slavery, well, we know that's wrong because of much evidence, but conscription is forcing people into involuntary servitude for the purpose of freeing people from involuntary servitude.
Yeah.
Really?
Yeah. So they drafted war slaves to free slaves. All right. Yeah.
Makes no sense whatsoever. So in Lincoln's speech, he said a couple of things that were just blaring lies. First off, he said that that there was peace everywhere except in the battlefield zones. And by saying that, he was intentionally throwing out propaganda that was contrary to what he knew was happening in New York City and across Kentucky and across Ohio and in Indiana. He knew he was lying, but he said this anyway. And he said, oh, we've got all this great peace and we should be thankful for it. And then what he did, he used the proclamation to sort of smooth over the fact that he was introducing a new tax and he was debasing the currency again. So this was a sleight of hand by government. We'll get back in a minute with some of the pilgrim part of the story.
We'll be back with the pilgrims after this trip to the market. After this trip to the kitchen for more turkey.
You're listening to Freedom Feens. So much truth, it hurts.
Freedom Feeds. So much truth, it hurts. So Ben Stone, the Bad Quaker, lay some more truth, drop some more mad scientists, and tell us about the other fib that is forced by law into children's brains about the day we're having right now. And we're not trying to make you feel bad. Enjoy your turkey. Enjoy your family. Love each other. Don't hit each other over the head when you get drunk. But let this stuff sink in over the coming days. So tell us about the pilgrims, Ben. My dad loves the pilgrims, by the way. I mean, he's going to call me today. He is going to call me today, and he's going to talk about the wonders of the pilgrims. He's going to do that. And it's he's 93, and he went to a one-room schoolhouse during the Great Depression and after, and grew up as a farmer. And he has a simple, beautiful, childlike, incorrect view of a lot of history. And a lot of Americans do, man. I love the guy, and I'm going to just grip my turkey and, you know, chew my turkey and listen to him when he calls me today to tell me wonders about the pilgrims. So go ahead and tell me about them and how they were the first nanny staters in America too, as well as they murdered a bunch of people.
Yeah, it's not necessary to, especially with older people like that, it's not necessary to try to pop their bubble and prove them wrong and hurt their feelings by telling them, you know that the everything that they believe is based on.
I won't do it. You can't teach an old dog new tricks, man. I will let him have that one.
No, I don't try to correct my...
He's right sometimes. He's the guy that came up with the line, Barack Obama is a liar, he's a socialist, and his feet stink. And we say that on every show, and it's a tip of our hat to truth that has come out of my 93-year-old dad's mouth. God bless him.
So in the earlier parts, I was talking about this George Washington lie and how Abraham Lincoln played off of that to try to unite the country, to try to get them to stop the riots that were going on throughout the country for different reasons. And so Lincoln pulled this trick from Washington to try to calm the nation and unite the nation. And he did it through an edict, through saying, this is how it's going to be, and this is how you're going to behave. And that's what we don't like. We don't need that. We can have a day of Thanksgiving without the government saying you have to do this on this day. But now, without the pilgrim aspect of this whole story, you wouldn't have the myth. You wouldn't have the gods way back in the distance of time. You wouldn't have these wonderful, just holy childlike people that we could imagine lived long ago that we call the pilgrims. So as the next couple segments go here, I'm just going to try to explain a little bit to you who the pilgrims were and why it is that we don't need them. We don't need them to thank our family members, and if you believe in God, which I do, you don't need the pilgrims to thank God for the blessings you have. Okay, so the pilgrims were actually Puritans, or at least the Puritans are the people that we have labeled as the pilgrims. And the whole myth about them is really, as a Quaker, the whole pilgrim myth is really painful, because I do know the truth about this stuff because I have read it. And a good source to read up on the Puritans was a book by Murray Rothbard called Conceived in Liberty. And it's originally it was like a 3-volume set. Now it's out in a 1-volume set. And it's really worth getting. If you look around on the internet, you can get it for free or you can get audio versions of it. But Murray goes through without, you know, any of the fluff of government history, and he just goes with the facts and he documents everything. So the stuff that I'm telling you in this part right here about the Puritans is lifted straight out of Murray Rothbard's book. And a little bit more, too. I've actually read, like I'm going to be talking about Cotton Mather, and I've actually read his sermons, and I've read some of his pamphlets and so forth that he was circulating. So then, who really were the Pilgrims? Well, let's start with this Mayflower thing. And I only have about another minute here, so I can't go into the entire thing, other than to say that most of the people in the Mayflower were not Puritans. Most of the people in the Mayflower were either hired sailors, or they were hired as labor, and they would work for a certain amount of time for the Puritans in the New World, and then they would be set free. That was the deal that they had signed on to. And the Puritans had signed a contract with a corporation back in the Old World that paid for the ship that they were on, that paid for the Mayflower and paid for their trip there. And the deal was they were going to go to Virginia to land that this corporation owned in Virginia, and they were going to develop and farm this land in Virginia, and their investors were going to take a portion of it, and the Puritans were going to get a portion of it, and the laborers were going to labor until they were through with their obligation, and then they would be set free. And they didn't do that. They lied. They lied to their sponsors, and they lied to the people on board ship. More when we get back.
Yep. More truth about the lies when we get back on the Freedom Fiends.
You're listening to the Freedom Fiends, and I'm beaming these words into your cerebellum.
Stone the Bad Quaker, drop some more mad science about history that they don't teach you in school here. Please, take it away, brother.
So, Michael, you're not a gun grabber, right? You're a gun guy.
Well, I grab a gun when I hear a noise late at night, but no, I would never grab other people's guns unless they were pointed at me, and then I would probably use a gun to facilitate the grabbing of the gun from the aggressor.
The Puritans were gun grabbers. When they entered the ship, the Mayflower, they made sure that nobody had any weapons on board except the Puritans themselves and the captain of the ship. And it's very likely, it's impossible to tell now with the material that we have at hand, but it's very likely that the captain of the ship was in on this deal right from the beginning, or he was convinced at some point in time, or they had bought him off and he was part of it in that sense. But they sailed to the New World. They got to Virginia, off the coast of Virginia. They had sort of a little Puritan takeover. Since the Puritans were only ones with guns, and everybody else, and the Puritans were the minority on the ship, the Puritans, the armed Puritans, forced the unarmed sailors and laborers to sign an absolute guarantee. And it broke all their ties with their sponsors that paid for the ship that got them there, and it broke all the rules and all the agreements that they had made to get the laborers that far. But they had to sign it. They had no choice. They had guns pointed to their heads. So then they sailed north, landed in Massachusetts, and started their own colony there. Now, these were not great people. I would challenge somebody to find out about a guy named Cotton Mather. Cotton Mather was the son of Increase Mather, who was, if it's possible, worse than Cotton Mather. But Cotton Mather, one of the most remarkable things about him, he was a leading theologian of the time, an author, he was a Puritan minister, and he was a pamphleteer. And he wrote a pamphlet in the early 1700s telling slaves that they should be happy as slaves, that was the position God had put them in, and that it was rebellion to God for them to want to be free. And he wrote in the same pamphlet, he wrote that masters had a God-given right to be masters by the very fact that they were masters. So that gives you an idea of Cotton Mather. Cotton Mather did another thing that's really remarkable. He believed, now you have to understand another thing about Puritans, they believed that if you were poor, it was because God was cursing you. And so the poor people were probably, this was their belief, poor people were probably sinful and evil, and that's why God was cursing them with poverty. And then, and they really believed that. They believed it was some of the mainline stuff of Puritanism. And so Cotton Mather found out that it was possible to take blankets and expose the blankets to people who had smallpox.
Oh, yeah, chemical biological warfare. It was biological warfare. Yep.
So Cotton Mather supported the idea of getting blankets with smallpox. Now, hold on to your horses, folks, and giving them to the poor people in Boston.
That's terrorism. I mean, today, like, if you were caught with any amount of smallpox, you know, in a vial, you know, in your freezer or something, not saying anybody should be able to have smallpox. I'm not advocating for the right to keep and bear smallpox. I'm saying, you know, now you're charged with terrorism for even having that stuff. And this is the government and the people you are taught in government school to worship using smallpox as a biological weapon to kill, 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 kill the poor, kill, 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 kill the poor, as the dead Kennedys sang sarcastically.
Yeah, and just to give some...
That song's not about smallpox, but it is about how governments like to kill the poor.
And just to give this some background, Cotton Mather's father that I mentioned a minute ago was the president of Harvard. So that's the level of importance that we're talking about. Cotton Mather was maybe the most important Puritan theorist of his day, or theologian of his day. And of course, this led to later on blankets being sent to the Native Americans in the same fashion, specifically in upstate New York, for the purpose of giving them smallpox. So that's, when we're talking about the Puritans, that's the real Puritans that we're talking about. I've got a really quick story too that I always love to read this in Rothbard's Conceived in Liberty. There was, and I'm not going to go through the details of all the different individuals and their names and everything like I did with Cotton Mather there, but there was a time frame in the 1600s where there were Quakers in New England, and they didn't much appreciate the fact that the Puritans had laws that said everybody has to pay a church tax and everybody has to attend church every single Sunday and everybody has to dress according to the Puritan dress codes. Now, the Quakers were a lot more easygoing, and they didn't believe one day was any more important than any other day, and they didn't believe in paying taxes to support Puritan churches, and they didn't believe that one person should be able to tell another person how they had to dress. And so this caused some problems with Quakers that were living in New England, where the Puritans were the primary political control was in their hands. And so the Puritans decided to start picking out leaders among the Quakers and punishing them for this evil, sinful behavior of not wanting to pay their taxes and not wanting to wear the proper clothes and not wanting to go to church on Sunday. So one of the prominent Quaker women, and this is an elderly woman, by the way, they stripped her naked, they beat her publicly, they tied her to the back of a wagon, and they marched her naked around town as an example to the other Quakers that you will follow the Puritan laws, and if you don't, this is what we'll do to your elderly women. And so the Quakers were at a They were confused about this because they were pacifists. They couldn't take up arms and fight the Puritans. So they talked among themselves, what are we going to do? What are we going to do? And they came up with a unique solution that I just find wonderfully comical. They said, okay, well, evidently the Puritans don't like the clothing that we wear. And evidently the Puritans want us to go to church on Sunday. And so let's everybody, as many Quakers as are willing to do this, let's all do this fun thing. And they all showed up on the same Sunday morning at every church that they could, and they just started marching up and down the aisles of the Puritan churches stark naked. And it was shocking to these Puritans. They literally didn't know how to handle it. They didn't know what to do. It was so overwhelming to them. And keep in mind, this is the 1600s. Also, at the time, and I'm reiterating that the Puritans were very pro-slavery at the time, a lot of people say, well, yeah, but that was then, and they didn't know the things we know now. Yeah, no, that's not the case, because Quakers were anti-slavery and were publishing pamphlets and distributing information on how a society could work without slavery, and they were doing that in the 1600s, and that was one of the biggest reasons that the Puritans really hated the Quakers. It was only, you know, they were irritated that the Quakers didn't want to pay their tax, and they were irritated that they didn't want to wear the right kind of clothes or show up on Sunday. But they hated the fact that the Quakers could take actual scripture and logic and reason and show that the Puritans were wrong, that slavery was bad, and that no good Christian should support slavery. And that infuriated the Puritans. Now, again, Thanksgiving had nothing to do with these people. The Puritans would sometimes have a day of Thanksgiving. The Quakers would have a day of Thanksgiving. The Catholics would have a day of Thanksgiving. But it was an individual thing. It was not mandated by the government. And we can have a day of Thanksgiving today. We can have that. We can enjoy our friends. We can enjoy our family. It's just not necessary to be told what to do by the government. We can do these things without polluting a word like Thanksgiving Day and pigeonholing it into one day and forcing us to only do that on one day. Why? Why? So that they can hurt us all on the freeways and give us tickets, so that they can jam us all into shopping malls on one day, and so they can milk us out for foods that we don't normally eat. I like turkey all the time. I like turkey all year long, and I love mashed potatoes, and I like, you know, cranberry dressing, and I like all that stuff. I like it all the time, and there's just no reason to bring it down to one day. But you know, that doesn't mean you can't enjoy today. That means that just means that we don't have to have the government telling us this. So when you're thinking about these things about the, you know, here's one last thing about the Puritans too, before I stop beating on those poor guys. There's a commercial on TV that's been running here lately, you know, coming up onto the Thanksgiving holiday and everything. And it's where this little kid asks his mom, you know, why do the Puritans wear a buckle on their hat? And she's at loss for an answer, so she just says, oh, and she gives him some half-baked answer. Well, there actually is a reason that the Puritans dressed the way that they did. And the clothing that we see nowadays is a bit exaggerated from what they actually had. But the point of Puritan clothing was exactly the same as what the Bible describes the way the Pharisees and the Sadducees did their clothing. It was to overemphasize the collar and overemphasize the sleeves, overemphasize the prayers, overemphasize how godly you are, and push it in everybody's face. That's what the Puritans were all about. The Puritans were about controlling government and using government to inflict their beliefs upon everybody else. And the bigger your hat was, and the bigger the buckle on your hat, and then they actually had like a little belt around their hat to hold it on. That was the purpose of the buckle. But the bigger that they could emphasize these things, the more they could show how great they were and how pure they were and how much more they loved God than you. And I already said one last thing, but here's a real one last thing about the Puritans. It's literally written in their documentation that they didn't believe that they believed that Puritans were the chosen of God. And if you weren't a Puritan, you were not a chosen of God. You were a subhuman. And it was literally okay to enslave you, to beat you, and if necessary, even to kill you. It was perfectly okay, so long as it benefited the Puritans. Now, that's how fanatical these people were. They split England through a bloody civil war. They invaded Ireland. They divided the former ruling classes in Ireland that had a voluntary type government in Ireland. They broke that all up. They inflicted upon Ireland a top-down government ran by the English. This is what the Puritans brought. It's not just, you know, shooting a turkey and getting along with an Indian and sharing some corn. They looked at the Indians as subhuman, and that's why they had no problems at all doing the horrible things they did, like raiding Indian camps, raiding into Canada, raiding the French Canadians every couple of years in order to fill the loots, to loot the banks and everything for Massachusetts. This is how they did. They didn't have a problem stealing from their neighbors in Canada or stealing from their neighbors that were American Indians. So when we come back from the next break, we've got a little bit of time here, but when we come back from the next break, we want to mostly focus on how you can still enjoy your family. You can still enjoy the fun of getting together and, you know, watching a football game, or if you're into it, having an adult beverage, or whatever it takes to be with your family and have a lot of fun.
Worms, we'll be back. We'll be back after this trip to the market on the Freedom Fiends.
Listening to Freedom Fiends with Michael Dean and some of his weird friends. And yes, we're broadcasting this into space.
Freedom Fiends. Warm and fuzzy redemption in the third act for the final segment on Thanksgiving 2014. Mr. Ben Stone is passed out from too much turkey and talking, and we're going to pass the speaking stick over to Lousander Feen. Take it, Lou.
Well, thank you, Michael, and thank you for all that wisdom that you dropped on us, Ben. I've never been in the studio audience of a Bad Quaker podcast, and it was really neat. But yeah, and as far as Thanksgiving goes, it's what you make of it. Yeah, you could recite the lies that they teach you in the state indoctrination camps and say that the Puritans came here to be free from persecution, but in reality, they came here to be free to persecute. You can talk about how Lincoln had, you know, created slavery to stop slavery and just all these other lies and everything, but it doesn't mean anything. It means absolutely nothing. In the first hour of the show, I talked about how after my mother had passed away, my father and I would go up to the UP and do our deer hunting around Thanksgiving time, and that was really nice. He's moved down south now, so I really don't have a whole lot of family up here that I'm in contact with, so distant relatives. But what I will be doing is I will be meeting up with my friends at the Status Recovery House, and we'll have a very nice turkey dinner, and amazingly enough, I don't think that Danny has had her kitchen certified by the health inspector.
Are your hippies? I know you have some hippies. Are your hippies? Are your anarcho-capitalist hippie friends? Are they vegetarians or are they real people?
Oh no, they consume more bacon than probably most of the people at Porkfest did.
Okay, cool.
Yeah, they always have bacon in their satchels. But yeah, I'm going to spend some
emergency bacon.
Yeah. Yeah. Or they just create it out of thin air like art. But so I'll be at the Status Recovery House eating unregulated food, and I'll be spending time with my hippies, Mary and Jason. My buddy Joe will be there. He's the really tall guy. And when I say tall, I mean mutant tall. Shannon will be there. You saw the picture of her. She was the door woman at Liberty Fest. And we're going to get together and we're going to have an elaborate meal. And we're going to laugh and joke and have fun. And it's just going to be a blast. But aside from cooking up a turkey, it's no different than any other day. You know, this is what we do on a regular basis, probably two or three times a month at least, usually. And it's, you know, for us, every day is Thanksgiving because we have each other. They're a great bunch. And there's going to be more people there, too. I just don't know who all is going to be showing up. But, yeah, it's a really great time. And I look at an opportunity to spend time with my chosen family, my non-biological family, as something to be thankful for. Just like doing this show. I mean, I come on here once every week or two and have a good time talking to my fellow fiends, and it's just good times. How about you, Ben? Do you have anything planned for tomorrow? I know Cindy's going to be doing something elaborate.
Yeah, Cindy always cooks a lot of turkey and a whole bunch of stuff, and we just got a turkey today. We just finished a turkey a couple days ago, and we're having our second turkey. So yeah, we really enjoy that, and it's unfortunately we're not going to be able to be with our family because we're traveling on the road and everything, and this is the first time that my wife hasn't been able to do a big thing with the family and have all the kids around and grandson and all of that. So we are missing that. And it's one of the saddest parts of being on the road, but you know, they're still with us in our heart, and that's pretty important too.
Yeah.
Yeah. And being from Detroit, I definitely won't be watching football tomorrow. not that I watch football.
I'm from Wyoming. We don't have a team.
People here, I'm from Detroit. We funny. Don't have a team
it's,
either.
It's funny because people here have Denver sports team bumper stickers, but in general, people also have a lot of like, get out of, go back to Colorado stickers here too. So everyone's confused if they're a sports fan here, unless it's rodeo.
Move away, we're full.
There's a lot of rodeo, man. And rodeo's fun. All right. Thank you.
Rodeo's a great American tradition, by the way.
Thank you, Ben Stone, the Bad Quaker, and Lousander Feen for your service here on Thanksgiving Day 2014. I've had a good time, and I'm going to go eat some more turkey.
It was a pleasure being had.
Thank you for having me. It was a pleasure being had. Try that one on your relatives and see how it goes. All right. I'd like to say worms, which is how we say word, which is how we say aloha, hello, goodbye. I concur. I agree with you and wish to subscribe to your newsletter. And it also means I have not been contacted by the government. If we ever switch to saying word instead of worms, or if one person ever starts saying word exclusively, it means that person's been contacted by the government and cannot speak of it. It is our warrant canary. So have some warrant canary or some turkey, and thank you for your service.